The Dana Show.
Everybody's going to go into adrenal exhaustion with the way that some of these people are covering this stuff. And they do it for clicks. That's what ticks me off. When you FA, you're going to FO. A consequence of busting up into a country, kidnapping the kids, kidnapping the wives, and, you know, generally being terrorist thugs, is that you might have your place of origin temporarily turned into absolute glass.
The Dana Show.
They also were able to obtain the cargo manifest. Now, the cargo manifest, we did bring in one of NTSB's senior hazmat investigators today to begin to look at the cargo and the cargo manifest. He was able to identify 56 containers of hazardous materials. That's 764 tons of hazardous materials, mostly corrosives, flammables, and some miscellaneous hazardous materials, class 9 hazardous materials, which would include lithium ion batteries. Some of the hazmat containers were breached. We have seen sheen on the waterway. The federal, state, and local authorities are aware of that, and they will be in charge of addressing those issues. But the NTSB, as part of our safety safety investigation, documents that type of release, documents the damage, and documents the type of materials involved as part of our investigation.
Do you guys feel better that Pete Buttigieg, Poot Buttigieg,
that sounds right.
Juicy Boot? No. Yeah. Oh, new name. That he's on the case. When it rains, it pours for these people. I feel so bad for them because now they're like, well, great, there goes our water. Everything's ruined. Welcome back to the program. We're on a new day. It's Thursday. Dana Lash here with you, top of this first hour. Listen coast to coast. It's just so bad. I feel so bad for these people. And then I was reading, too, the strategy that they're trying to figure out to get the rest of these ships out of this port is out of this world. Like, I would not want that headache for anything. They're scrambling, trying to figure out how to best make this work. Because there are a number of ships still in there that they can't get out. They're still in there. They're trying to, and they've got shipments. They've got, you know, there's some stuff that's, you know, timely. They're trying to figure out, you know, the best way to do this. It's really tough for them. And so this is the latest. And the cost, somewhere around what, $50 million or billion dollars for this to get this cleaned up, to get it fixed, to get everything situated, because that bridge, I mean, you got to go all the way down to the foundation, apparently, to fix this, is what some of the preliminary analysis was. So it's bad. There's no good news coming out of this at all. Now, in the meantime, with this, and we have more on it coming up, you have Donald Trump and Joe Biden in New York City for very different reasons. Trump is attending the visitation of the slain New York PD officer, Jonathan Diller. Remember, Jonathan Diller, he was killed this was on Far Rockaway. He was shot by this ex-con during a traffic stop. And traffic stops are so incredibly dangerous for police. We've had this conversation before. They're so dangerous for them. And he was shot and killed. He leaves behind a wife and an infant son. Just horrific. And you have Joe Biden and Donald Trump both in New York today. Joe Biden is doing, he's not going to the visitation. He's going to a big fundraiser. And I was looking, they're looking at raising just short of $500,000 with this thing. Mm-mm-mm. That's a lot of money. He's going with, got the Clintons there and Barack Obama. He didn't call in Hillary Clinton, which I think is funny. He called in Bill Clinton and Barack Obama because Hillary Clinton is notorious for not being able to raise money. And so they're bringing in Bill Clinton and Barack Obama to help. There goes all the Me Too stuff, by the way, to help raise money for them. And it looks like, I mean, they're gearing up. Actually, not 500, sorry. $25 million is what they're hoping to release. That's the, this is, here's my release from the Biden campaign. They are characterizing it as the most successful political fundraiser in American history. They're looking to raise over $25 million. I think, sorry, the $100,000 thing, that's, it's like several hundred thousand dollars per plate. That's what they're looking at. That's insane. So he has to combine Barack Obama and Joe Biden both in order to have a successful fundraiser. Hey, Kane.
Yeah.
When Trump does fundraisers like this, who does he bring in? Yeah, who does he bring in?
I guess the local politicians.
He doesn't, you know, like, try to bring in any... I mean, because Biden brings in Obama and Clinton.
Yeah, no, there's no... I don't think there's any politician.
So he doesn't bring in anybody?
No.
He doesn't bring in anybody else?
At best, he gets the local politicians there, which I think is a good idea.
Well, I'm just saying the reason I bring this up, because I feel like it's a need. Do you think Joe Biden is going to be able to show up himself and raise $25 million?
No, you're right.
Who's going to sit here and show, who's going to pay who's going to pay that much money to watch this guy, to come in and watch this guy?
That's a great point.
I'm just saying, you know, I got some thoughts. So that's, they're going to raise the money for him. But I don't know. I mean, that's just such a stark contrast of both of them in New York, and yet only one of them is going to this event, the visitation for this officer. Only one of them is going to this. To me, that seems really, gosh, that's just so tone deaf. That is so tone deaf. He's at a fundraiser today. $25 million at the same time that there's this visitation. I'm just, golly, guys, I tell you, this is wild. Now, the visitation, it's expected, this is going to go for 2 days. And this 31-year-old officer, he literally just, didn't he just join the force? He had just joined the force. Just joined it. And it's so sad. It's just so tragic. I mean, this guy was the guy who shot and killed him was a repeat offender. Both of them actually were. The ex-con that he stopped and the other dude, they were both repeat violent offenders. And, you know, you have the AG, all these other Soros-backed prosecutors all across New York that coddle these guys. They coddle them. They coddle these criminals. I mean, he had been barely 3 years on the job. Barely 3 years. And he came from a family of police officers, New York police officers. His, I believe the other men in his family were on the force. He had 70 busts under his belt, according to New York Post. His brother-in-law, his cousin, they're all cops. I mean, it's, he's got a baby boy. Leaves behind a baby boy who will never know his dad. And it was a career criminal. Traffic stop. I was noticing, too, on one of the publications coming out of New York, it has the NYPD cop killed, you know, by a career criminal at traffic stop. And then it gets into madman shoves commuter to death on subway tracks. And then how someone else almost got shoved onto the subway tracks. Absolute lawlessness in this city. And they do nothing. Absolutely nothing. It's amazing. Now, this contrast, this is the stuff that the Biden campaign doesn't think of, and he should, at the very least, he'll never go to Diller's visitation. He can't go to Diller's visitation, because if he goes to Diller's visitation, then he has to deal with the reality of what his party's policies cost. He can't go because it's like self-incrimination. And he wouldn't be welcome there anyway, because people are blaming his policies, Democrat policies, Soros-backed prosecutor policies, for creating this horrific tragedy. They're really, they're not wrong. They're not wrong. So this is what we're watching today, just how this unfolds in New York. Now, in the meantime, some of the 2024 stuff, there are some new polls out showing that somehow it looks like RFK Jr., I'm pulling this up, they're trying to say RFK Jr. is worse for Biden than Trump. And I don't know if I necessarily agree with that. I want everybody to be very, very careful about this stuff. I think that his selection, RFK Jr.'s selection of a far left VP candidate, a lot of independents that I have seen, a lot of people on the left that I have seen, they have not welcomed that selection. They don't think a lot of that selection. But is it going to be enough to push them into voting against Biden? Because you have to remember, the left is their very hive mind. They're incredibly hive mind about stuff. They will circle the wagons. They'll circle the wagons. They'll protect their own. If that's what it means, they'll do it. So if it's enough to actually divide enough on the left for Biden, I don't know. I just don't trust a lot of the polling anymore. Because remember, it's all people who have landlines. I mean, they don't poll. You're already biased in your sampling because you're getting people, older people typically. And it's not because, you know, for the people who the drive-bys who have no reading comprehension because they're the product of incest, to explain that better, it is biased sampling, not as a pejorative against older generations, but it's biased sampling because you're literally only sampling people who still have landlines. And there's a certain demographic, just factually, statistically, that still has landlines. I don't even have a landline. I don't know anybody who has a landline. I don't know anybody who has a home number still. Everyone has their own cell phones. And so that's how these surveys are done. So that's why I'm like, I just don't know. Because still, when you get to the more the younger generations, like Gen X and millennials and even Gen Z, they tend to be a little bit more radical and they will circle the wagons. They have that learned instinct. They will circle the wagons around a candidate. Whether that remains to be seen, I don't know. But I just know at the same time, he is not at Ross Perot levels of division, of dividing the vote. RFK Jr. is not there yet, and his VP pick may have cost it. Now, whoever Trump picks, and this is something we're going to watch in the coming weeks, you know, whoever his VP pick is, that may determine whether or not the election and how it's run and how the candidates are campaigning, whether that's thrown a little bit leftward as opposed to him campaigning, you know, as a more right-leaning candidate. We're going to watch and follow all of this as we get moving towards the bottom of this first hour. And our partners, committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
This is like so the most appropriate thing I can ever imagine happening. Because you know where NASCAR comes from, right? Moonshine runners, right? This is during Prohibition. You had souped up cars and they were racing away from the law so they could deliver that liquor to them speakeasies and elsewhere on those rural roads all throughout the United States. I mean, it's part of our country's heritage. That's literally where NASCAR came from. Well, check this out. The officials at a historic North Wilkesboro Speedway in the foothills of North Carolina discovered a literal moonshine cave just by chance when a sinkhole opened up underneath the racetrack's grandstands. Now, if you're at a racing event, you're at a NASCAR event, and a sinkhole opens up and you fall into it, you want it to be a moonshine cave. I'm just saying, if you're going to fall into any sinkhole, let it be a moonshine cave sinkhole. So track employees have been cleaning and inspecting. They noticed cracks in the concrete. And so they're like, yeah, it's a secret moonshine still, essentially. And they're renovating and restoring the North Wilkesboro Speedway. They've been doing it since 2022. But yes, they said that they found some places where you could make some illegal liquor. I'm imagining already like a whole experience, right? Like you're going to watch the thing that came about from Prohibition, and underneath you can go for like a little extra and a ticket and go get you some moonshine down there. Like, call me. I've got so many ideas for how to monetize this. It's insane. Joe Lieberman has passed away at age 82, according to Politico. Apparently had to do with complications related to an earlier fall. He was the longtime senator from Connecticut. He was also kind of a moderate Democrat, and Democrats really started hating him towards the end of everything because as they turned more left, he seemed more conservative. But it was due to complications from a fall. He was 82 years old. This guy set a record for essentially dragging his beans across concrete all the way, you know, around New York. He's a fitness trainer who broke 2 Guinness World Records by doing lunges across New York City. Kane's like, that just seems, I don't know, pretentious, right? Do I have to sit here and give accolades for everything? Do I? I feel really put out when I'm expected to pat people on the back for like the stupidest stuff, right? Oh, you did, oh my God. This is interesting too. This piece I was reading about the AI staffing war. Mark Zuckerberg and Sergey Brin, who's the guy who founded Google, they've been pulling out all the stops to hire top tier talent in the field of AI. They're personally reaching out to candidates to try to get them to win them over to their side. Stick with us. We got more in store.
Are you capable? Are you ready to step into the role and do whatever the country would need?
Absolutely ready. But thank God our president is in good shape, in good health, and is ready to lead in our second term.
Is he, though? He's ready to lead in the second term. Do you really feel confident about her claim there? Welcome back. That's the VP, Kamala Harris. Dana Loesch here with you. Top of the second hour. You can listen coast to coast. You can stream the program, Channel 347 DirecTV as well. You can also find us YouTube, Facebook, Substack, the chapter and verse, the newsletter. No one believes that. You know, he apparently has no work before 10 a.m. He goes for a 45-minute workout when he wakes up. I was looking at a couple of different pieces on this. There's one over at Politico, there's one at Daily Mail. What?
I was told that Biden does more in an hour than most of us do all day.
Well, he does a 45-minute workout when he gets up. Let me see if you do more in your day, King.
All right.
So, you know, he gets out of bed, not usually before 10.
Ooh.
45-minute workout, physical therapist. He focuses on balance exercises, reportedly.
I just walk.
Yeah. He usually gets to his Oval Office desk after 10, and he leaves before 7. Most of his activities, his public events, are scheduled between 10 and 4, because they say that's when he's at his sharpest.
He probably has dinner right after.
Yeah. They usually they call, he's late to everything and they call it Biden time. Follow-up questions are limited. Like when he got the Egyptian leader's name wrong. They were worried about him tripping. So, like, you know, he does all that stuff. If he has to go anywhere, he, I mean, it already sounds like he's got a pretty lax day, I got to say, right?
Yeah.
You know, 1 hour, as you said, and more than 1 hour. Secret Service agents put an agent now on the stairs, an extra agent at the bottom, apparently. And he got new black sneakers, but he apparently stumbled up the stairs again yesterday because he didn't have his black sneakers on. But he apparently got special sneakers that he's supposed to wear when he goes up the stairs. So, yeah, 7-8, his cat wakes him up. His 4-year-old American short-haired tabby called Willow. An insider, White House insider, says the cat wakes him up. Jill Biden is already up doing a spin class.
Cat does not wake him up.
That's what they say.
It's a lie.
Yeah.
The cat doesn't care.
Biden gets at least 8 or 9 hours of sleep. Obama apparently slept 5 to 7. Trump usually slept 5 to 6. And they said George W. was the weirdo because he would wake up at like 5 in the morning and he would read newspapers and have coffee and start his day at like 6. That's not weird. It's not totally weird. But he does his mobility workout with his physical trainer, and he's not in the office, but, you know, he's definitely not in his office before 10. So, I don't know. He doesn't, it sounds like his, I mean, because he was just back at his beach house last weekend, right? But he left, he didn't come back till like, Tuesday? Something to that effect?
Do we have any video of him doing a workout, like a 45-minute?
No, but I have a million photos of him sitting on his beach chair. And I also have a million photos of Secret Service standing in the full sun on the beach. And I feel bad for them. I'm like, they can't be under an umbrella. No, they're at least in short sleeve shirts.
Oh, that's good.
Button up short sleeve shirts. But, you know, that's just, I feel bad for them. But yeah, he's got note cards for his whole day. Everything. He's just, I don't know, man. It's just weird. He goes to bed before 11. So if he's anywhere after 7, that's late for him.
Your commute, workouts, or downtime with the Dana Show podcast. Unleash the power of knowledge at your fingertips by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
So we're just, I got to come in. First, welcome back. Got a little Fogarty, right?
Yeah.
Put me in, coach, because it's opening day, guys. It's opening day of baseball season, the only time I actually pay attention to any kind of sports. It's baseball season. Now, technically, God's team doesn't have it's opening day until April 4th, technically, where the whole city would shut down, right? As Kane knows. And Kane and I, and again, Dana Lash, welcome back. Hometown St. Louis, right? I don't say that lightly. I realize it is Holy Week. And God's team, oh, that's for those of you who are heathens, that is the St. Louis Cardinals. Their opening day is on April 4th, where they play the Miami Marlins. So the whole city would shut. People don't understand this. St. Louis is such a baseball town. Like, they make you move if you don't like the team. I'm not, am I kind of kidding? I don't know.
A little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit kidding.
Yeah. Like, I remember when I was still at my affiliate, one of the, when I was still based in St. Louis, and there was a new person. It was like a, I think it was a salesperson, Kane, that moved in, and it was like a get to know you, whatever thing. And, you know, it felt like an office situation, like Office Space. And everyone had to go get to know the person, and they're like, oh, do you like baseball? And I just remember the answer was something like, oh, not really. Everyone got quiet. That's not allowed. The whole city shuts down. People used to skip school. Like, they just actually were trying to, they would give you an excused absence. The school that I went to, people were getting excused absences. They'd skip and they'd go to opening day. Can you remember how hardcore this was? The whole city shut. Crime stops. The gangs are like, all right, we're going to stop drugging and shooting. It's opening day.
It's been going on for decades.
I'm not kidding. Like, crime drops. It's crazy. It's like the wildest thing ever. So it's opening day. So our friend Larry gave me a really good idea. Vegas Larry. I am on the, I got to admit, I'm on the struggle bus because there's a lot of good options. One of the things that I love about opening day, because sometimes the players switch it up, their walk-on song, right? Everybody gets a walk-on song. It's your one chance to pick the song as your walk-on song, right? So I'm curious, what would y'all's walk-on song be? If you're a player, right? I think all of you have already thought of this. I just have a suspicion that you all already know this, right? I mean, I've got some ideas. Kane immediately, I didn't even finish my sentence. Because you can't have the same walk-on song that other people do. You got to pick something else if they pick it.
It's got to be unique.
Yeah, yeah. Kane's immediately like, well, Walk by Pantera. Like, he planted the flag in it immediately. No one else can touch it now. He's like, yeah, Walk by Pantera. It does sound particularly hardcore. Like, when you're coming out to bat.
Yeah, that iconic intro. Wait, to that song.
Slow down, because I have all these queued up. One
Steve has them queued up. For the radio audience, because you get the benefit of the license.
See, I'd be walking
that pays
up to the plate.
For it.
I'd be walking up to the plate right here. I'd be choking up on the bat.
Right?
Hitting
can you
my
like, yeah, you're.
Hitting my cleats,
exactly.
Hitting the dirt out of my cleats. Stepping
I mean,
up to
it's
the plate.
It's hardcore. People are going to be afraid
into the
of
box.
You.
Getting ready for that first pitch.
See?
Loving
it is. This might be the walk-on song of all walk-on songs.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm on the struggle bus because I have to admit this was on my list too.
Feel like I could hit a home run with this one.
You feel like you could knock the stitches out the ball with this one.
I think so.
I mean, that's just, it's Pantera, number one. I mean, it's, you know, God's band. It's, don't at me. It's like, it's such a good walk-on song. Now, here's your all's assignment. A little fun, you know, because it's been heavy. It's been heavy politics. And you need a break from the primary, from the election for a little bit. You got to have your walk-on song and then a backup walk-on song. And I apologize to those of you that are watching the simulcast. We can't afford the licensing that it costs in order to play the songs that we're choosing to you. So you can only get it if you're listening to the radio broadcast. It's $11 quadrillion, in case you were wondering. Like, GoFundMe would laugh at it. So that's Kane's. Do you have a backup?
Yeah. Mine was, I'm thinking of songs that have iconic intros that when you hear them, you're like, oh, man, I got to stop whatever the hell I'm doing and listen to this. Is Back in Black from AC/DC.
Oh, that's a good one. Because immediately got that hi-hat and then, oh.
Here it is. Also.
It's, yeah.
Easily choke up on the bat, walk up to the plate, knock the dirt off my cleats.
You can tell that
box.
He's thought about this a lot. Kane has, like, really thought about this a
Sizing
lot.
Sizing up the pitcher. So I walk into the box, dig in, and get ready to slam it over the wall.
It's amazing. Yeah. So I was thinking about it. Let me ask you, Steve. Steve is our resident millennial. And I'm a little worried about asking this because I have no idea what he's going to throw at us. Steve, you're a baseball player. It's opening day. Your walkout song, sir.
So I am in a rec league, a softball league in D.C. for 7 years. I can't repeat the team name because it's inappropriate for radio. But not only is my walk-up song is my favorite song of all time, and it's this one.
What?
Also my favorite group of all time.
What is this?
Seriously?
Daft Punk.
I didn't know he'd... Wow.
I mean, I like Daft Punk, but I don't know if I would have gone with this intro.
It's the Daft Punk
I would have
remix.
Gone with D-Rez... Daft Punk, D-Rez from the Tron soundtrack. See if you can pull that up real quick, because that's
this
on my
Steve's
list.
This is Steve's walk-up song. Why are you trying to ruin his walk-up
yeah,
song?
Yeah, I just want to make him more. Let's I want to make him more. Okay.
Let him choose his own walk-up song.
This sounds
song.
Like you got a guy out there ready to hit the ball and maybe party. Okay, I can see the stadium. Like, yeah, right. It's our boy. I can see that.
Imagine
I can see
if
it.
He's already hit like a home run.
Oh
or
my
triple.
Gosh, the ladies like, be like time. Slingshot and panties. I mean, maybe not, but I get it. I get it.
You went all over the map on that one.
I did. See if you can pull up real quick Tron's D-Rez from, or Daft Punk's D-Rez track from Tron. I think it's that one.
Is this going to be one of your tracks, maybe?
If I'm thinking of the right song, it's been a bit since I've listened to this album. So, no, it's not this one. Never mind. It's the one where what's his face? Jeff Bridges drops into the club and he's getting ready to unleash a can of Whoop-A Double Snakes.
Is that End of the Line?
Maybe. We're going to go through this whole album. Everyone listening is like, can you talk about politics? No, I will.
No.
Give me a break.
Palate cleanser.
It's a palate cleanser. But it's such a great track. Now, while Steve looks at...
We can do Juan's in the meantime.
Yeah, let's do Juan's in the meantime. So Juan, they're already laughing. We're like, Juan, sir, you are a baseball player. It's opening day. Your walkout song is... What do we have?
You want to play? Okay, here we go.
Yeah, go ahead.
I told him not to Bad Bunny, but he picked Bad Bunny.
Oh, my gosh. He did pick Bad Bunny.
Booker T.
Yeah. Now, see, this is like one of the ones.
It's good that he's in a musical instrumental part of it.
Yeah, I think you kind of had to be for
I got the clean version.
Yeah. All right. We get it.
I could see this.
I get it. So see if you can pull up.
Like
so.
That.
That's good. Do you have a backup? Did he have a backup? Did he offer one?
I don't see a backup.
No, I don't think so.
Here.
Okay. See, pick up Fall by Daft Punk. See if that one's it in the meantime. So I don't know. I'm on the struggle bus.
Oh, wait, it is. You just put Daft Punk in there, didn't you, one?
Mm-hmm.
He did as a backup. Okay.
Yeah, good. What's his Daft Punk track?
Lose Yourself.
Ah, okay. Nice. So I have like my serious choices. I don't know if I actually want to talk about this on air anymore.
It's
I feel like
to be
we
two.
Need to feel like we need to switch.
And I think you have like 10 listed.
Oh my gosh,
and
I have
you
10.
Haven't been able
like
to
I have For Whom the Bell Tolls, Metallica. I've got Ride the
That's
Lightning, Metallica. I had Pantera
yeah,
Walk.
My backup
I had
my backup.
Rain and Blood by Slayer because the intro is Ooh. Just so boss. Can I have that intro? Because it's so amazing.
Rain and Blood by Slayer.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's like she might murder me with the ball. It's that. Like if I'm coming out opening day, I'm coming out for your soul, and that's how, you know.
It's supposed to be about peanuts and Cracker Jack.
Yeah,
and you're talking about
woo! Everything's a competition. Woo!
Consuming souls is what you're
yeah,
doing.
Yeah, I am.
Okay.
Go if you can, sir. Get that track going. Get that track going for us.
Oh man.
Gosh, that's amazing.
Do you remember the first time you heard this?
First time I heard it, my life was changed.
Right.
It's just beautiful.
Some people can't relate, but I don't
know. I'm not into chill. If I want to listen to chill music, I'm going to listen to like jazz or something. It's like, why go halfway when you can go all the way? You know what I'm saying? Like, just don't do anything halfway. I think this is my first choice would be Rain and Blood by Slayer. But I do like the Daft. I think it's Fall by Daft Punk off the Tron Legacy album. That would be like my backup because it's really cool. It's a super cool song. Or
is that the one you're embarrassed by?
No.
Oh. See, because that's the one I'm trying to get you to.
All right. So only Steve knows what the other one is.
Yeah, you wouldn't even share it with
me. I wouldn't even share it with you because I'm never going to live it down.
Oh, boy. Now I need to know.
Go ahead, Steve. Go ahead and play it and let's see if Kane knows who it is. Are you
I've
shocked?
Never heard this song. I've
Are you serious?
Song. No, I haven't.
Wait a minute. What? Now I'm really curious.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead. Let's see if Kane can guess what it is. I'm so bad. The people who are listening on the simulcast. I'm just saying, you got to wait for it to kick in. You got to, Kane's dying already. I hate you so bad. Wait, wait, wait for him to come in. Wait for it to come in. And here he goes. Yeah, I'm from the city. That is Rowdy Rowdy. It's Yellow Wolf. I'm not even going to lie. I'm not even going to lie. That
Yellow
would be
Wolf,
it.
Yellow Wolf
Rowdy
a,
is.
Yeah. Yellow Wolf had some good tunes.
That's all I'm going to say. It's all I'm going to say.
This is actually a good walk-up song.
It is a good walk-up song. And St. Louis is a rowdy city.
Yeah.
So
no, actually, I can see this happening. That's... With you carrying a big old Louisville slugger on your shoulder up to the plate.
Yeah,
yeah
right.
I can see that.
Spitting my backy out.
Yeah. I mean, as much as I wanted to make fun of you, that's actually pretty good.
It's very out of line for me. But I don't know what it is. I like it. I like it. I'm not going to lie. Anyway, so those are our walk-up songs. I'm curious as to what y'all's would be. What your walk-up songs would be, because it says a lot about a person. Lorraine picks Enter Sandman by Metallica. That is
solid.
An excellent, solid choice, Lorraine. Very solid choice. Because she's going to hit you with the ball and put you asleep. Get them home runs. Wah, wah. So that's so we're happy that it's opening day. We had to have a little fun. Even though April 4th, that's God's team's opening day, technically. You know, this is just, you know. But this is officially for MLB. This is opening day. So this is the only time when I'm like, going to pay attention to sports. Any other time I'm like, what's football? What? And then everyone else in Dallas, Texas looks at me like I'm a communist. So there's nothing that anybody can do to ruin opening day except if Joe Biden gives a speech or throws a pitch out. Can you imagine Joe Biden walking out? Oh, can we just look at that for a moment? Can you imagine him doing first pitch?
No. He would fall off the mound after that throw.
He'd fall off in his weird, like, giant platform Alexander McQueen Yeezys would flip off his feet. I don't even know what is he wearing.
He'd have too much forward momentum to stop and he'd fall forward right after the pitch.
And, oh my gosh. I think he would get booed, right? I think he would get booed hardcore.
Yeah, probably.
I think he would. Because he's not fun either. He's just, he goes out there and he squints it. He used to not do that all the time. Joe Biden used to not, like, make that, he used to not squint and make that mean face all the time. Now he does, and I don't know if he thinks that he has to do that to look tougher or if that's a consequence of the stroke that we're pretending he didn't have. Juan's got a picture that he's thrown up on the simulcast of them dim shoes, though.
They look sturdy.
They look like tires. You know how I don't like it when women walk around in giant platforms because they think they look like Clydesdales? Similarly, I don't like it when guys walk around in giant, thick, black tennis shoes like this because y'all look like you got tires for feet. Like you need to get them aired up or something. Check the air pressure on. It's just weird looking. I don't like it.
Shoe equivalent of dualies.
It is. It is. So we have, let me tell you what we got else on deck. We had a little palate cleanser. We got some serious stuff that we got to talk about, ladies and gentlemen. We've got to talk about the economy, right? Got to talk about Kane's phone ringing right now. He's dying. Like every day, we got to talk about some of this stuff. We also have to get into some of the cultural stuff, and we got Harmeet Dillon who's going to be joining us. She's the one. She's the lawyer representing the lady who was banned from the YMCA because she didn't like a dude in the women's locker room. And remember, we talked about this like a week or so ago. So Harmeet Dillon is going to be joining us about that coming up in our next hour as well. So we have a lot of stuff to hit that you don't want to miss. And as we get moving, so you know how important being prepared is to me. And that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
Don't let FOMO get the best of you. Stay in the loop and ahead of the curve by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
I think I might be open to it only if they offered me a Tesla truck and equity in and that I could go to see how dumb, how stupid that is. Listen, here's what I'll say. I don't think that that is.
Didn't he do that? He asked for, like, I would like Dr. Evil stuff. I would like $1 billion and a Tesla truck. Like all these things. That's what I would like. No. That's, I mean, you know, shoot for the moon. I mean, you miss all the shots you never take. True. Like, within reason, you know. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash here with you. I got to tell you, can I share this with you? I got to put this picture in Slack. And I want Juan to show you guys on the simulcast. Let me describe it to you for Steve has now put, or no, Juan's putting in his backup to back up to his walk-up song. You don't get a backup, Juan. I put this photo in Slack, and it's from Life at Delta, and it's, Kane's already dying. Someone retweeted it and said, how does this make you feel? And it's two chicks, they're cute chicks, and they're sitting in the cockpit. And they're like, and some broad asks, well, how does this make you feel? Some female asks, how does this make you feel? Do you want my honest, unvarnished opinion? Yeah. You gonna die. Y'all gonna die. That's my opinion. I think I'd turn right the hell around, walk off the plane. I don't know. It's just me. Steve, don't make me say what you put in Slack out loud. Just like I don't like young preachers, I also don't think I like super young pilots either. And I don't want a female preacher, and I don't want a female pilot, I think. I don't care if you get mad at that. Guess what? It's a big country. I can have different opinions, and everyone else can pound sand. I'm weird about it, right? I just, you know? Yeah, I'm just saying. We got more coming up second hour. We have lots of opportunities to make people feel uncomfortable, so stay with us. Tell me that you don't know the difference between natural and civil rights without telling me that you don't know the difference between natural and civil rights. Go.
The one thing that unites all of them, because there's many different groups orbiting Trump, but the thing that unites them as Christian nationalists, not Christians, by the way, because Christian nationalists is very different, mm-hmm. is that they believe that our rights as Americans, as all human beings, don't come from any earthly authority. They don't come from Congress. They don't come from the Supreme Court. They come from God.
So tell me you don't understand the difference between natural and civil rights without telling me that you don't understand the difference between natural and civil rights. Oh my gosh, this is just like basic reading comprehension. If you read the Declaration of Independence and you also read all of the debate minutes as it came to the founders determining what amendments and how they were going to structure the Constitution of the United States, there's one thing that they all agreed on. And it did not matter the doctrine through which you approached this. It just mattered that you recognize the activity and the guiding hand of the divine into the creation of the Republic, or how they were inspired to acknowledge the presence of the divine in everyday life, which is why you have what's considered, you know, our free speech and the free practice of religion and the right to bear arms, et cetera, et cetera. The difference between natural and civil rights is that natural rights are rights that you have by way of being an American, whether you are born here in the United States or in a territory like on a military base, or if you become a citizen of the United States. They are rights that you immediately assume, that you did not ask for, that you did not have to work for, that you did not vote for, that were not created in a courtroom by humans specifically for you. That is what a natural right is. And that is what the founders were alluding to when they said that we have been gifted by, endowed by our creator with unalienable rights. That is exactly what they're talking about. It is the very definition of a natural right. Civil rights are rights created by men and women in courtrooms to apply to other men and women. civil rights are rights created by men given to other men. They are not rights at all. Rather, they are privileges that have been decided by the state and given to the citizens of the state. That's it. That's the difference. And I think that this is an absolute bastardization, not only of the meaning of natural rights and the difference between natural and civil rights, but it shows a really embarrassing ignorance just in the understanding of the origin of our entire republic. And what's more, and I've seen this in the thread of this, Matt Wolking put out, I'm going to actually retweet it here in a moment, has this thread that people have filled there, all of these videos, like Joe Biden and John F. Kennedy, and I even think Barack Obama, and there was even Al Gore had given a speech where they're talking about natural rights. Like, for instance, listen to Joe Biden. This was back in 1987. I was in elementary school. 1987, where I guess that this MSNBC talking head would take the exact same objection to this. Listen.
I believe all Americans are born with certain inalienable rights. As a child of God, I believe my rights are not derived from the Constitution. My rights are not derived from any government. My rights are not derived from any majority. My rights are because I exist.
Now, see,
I have certain rights.
These people, like this woman on MSNBC, they're trying to ugly up the idea that you have rights that are untouchable by other men. Like, and that's the thing. To destroy belief in God in this country, and communists' biggest enemy is God. Karl Marx's biggest enemy was God. Because if you have these rights that are enshrined in the jurisdiction of the divine, no man can touch them. No man can pervert them. No man can counterfeit them. No man can corrupt them. And that's the entire goal, to very slowly whittle away the belief in the God who endowed these people with these rights, so that the jurisdiction can dissipate and those rights can be moved under the jurisdiction of man. And then they can be infringed upon. Actually, they'll convince you that it's not an infringement because it never was to begin with. That's what they'll convince you of. So this whole Christian nationalist term, this is an ignorant phrase, ignorant phrase used by even more ignorant people. And it's either done because they're genuinely and innocently stupid, which I still believe in a culpability in this era of information, or they're just malicious. And I think it's a bit of both.
The Dana Show.
think everybody's going to go into adrenal exhaustion with the way that some of these people are covering this stuff. And they do it for clicks. That's what ticks me off. When you FA, you're going to FO. A consequence of busting up into a country, kidnapping the kids, kidnapping the wives, and, you know, generally being terrorist thugs, is that you might have your place of origin temporarily turned into absolute glass.
The Dana Show.
President Biden will be in New York City for most of the day doing fundraising. Former President Donald Trump is going to the wake of the NYPD officer. I wondered if you mentioned that the president spoke to Mayor Adams. I wonder if he'd spoke to the family of the officer. And also, you know, Trump is blaming a lot of crime on Biden. I just wondered if you could speak a little bit about that.
Yeah, so I don't have any private communications to share at this time. Our hearts go out, obviously, to the officer's family and the broader NYPD family who have tragically lost one of their own. The president grieves for them and honors their sacrifice. Look, the president has stood with law enforcement his entire career and continues to stand with them as they put their lives on the line for their communities. Under his leadership, we'll continue to support police officers and ensure that they have resources they need to continue to do the work, the all-important work that they have to do on behalf of the community.
Yeah, that sounds like a canned statement. I mean, we just don't know. About the officer, because she doesn't know. Nobody thought to put that in KJP's little, like, binder. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash with you, top of this second hour. And just, she said that the president spoke to the mayor. He didn't speak to the family. Because if he had, they would have released a statement. They would have made that known. That he didn't speak to the family, just like he didn't speak to any of the family members at the Christian school in Nashville that was shot up by a trans activist. They didn't speak to anyone there. It just shows you where the priorities are. The contrast between Biden having a fundraiser in New York, which is, I mean, apparently like a six-figure a plate thing. They're looking to raise $25 million. And Trump in New York going to the visitation of this Officer Diller is stunning. I get the impression that Biden's campaign doesn't realize what a bad contrast that is, right? I mean, he's up there with Obama and Bill Clinton. Notice Hillary Clinton is not up there. It's Bill. Even though Hillary was the one who most recently held office and the one most recently politically active, Hillary cannot raise money and the base has never liked her. So it's always been Bill. So he's got Barack Obama and Bill Clinton up there raising money for that $25 million fundraiser that's what they'll walk out with to add to their several hundred million dollar war chest. And they haven't even started. That's why I'm not getting super. I'm not feeling super settled about what I'm reading with the polls, because if I'm being honest, everything is way too close for a president that unpopular. For Joe Biden to be as unpopular as he is, none of these polls should be that close. There's an enthusiasm problem on the Republican side that no one wants to talk about because they interpret it to mean that you're passing judgment or you are condemning either the former president or whatever. And it has nothing to do with that. I think part of the reason is because voters are fatigued. I think it was a mistake to start the primary so early. I also kind of think it was a mistake for Trump to start the primary so early. I don't know if he did so because of the legal stuff and he was trying to strategize about that. I don't know what it was, but it started so early. I mean, it should only really be just wrapping up now. And the reason I say that is because of this issue right here. There's some voter fatigue. When you keep people amped up, they can't stay amped up like that for an extended period of time. One of two things happens. They settle back down and they go back to just normalcy, or you have to introduce something that is more agitating than the first thing that got them all riled up, which then means in order to keep that sentiment going, you constantly have to introduce things to agitate voters or to rile them up or however you want to put it. And then that gets really tiring after a while. And I think it's a twofold thing. I think Republicans are guilty of doing it. The media already does it, and the left already does it by the way that they attack Republicans and the whole thing, like, for instance, with Ronna McDaniel and the ideological bigots at NBC. But Republicans do it too, and it's a problem because they shouldn't. You don't have to meet outrage with outrage every single time. Like, whenever I see something, I always will, you know, get an email or a text from a campaign like, did you see, you know, it's like a mass thing. You know, there are, you know, we're under attack, got to stop this. There's always some type of, and you can't keep that going because it makes voters exhausted. And that's the last thing that you need going into November, is an exhausted, fatigued voter, voting base. You cannot have that. That has been my warning from the get-go with this. Now, the way that I think that Republicans could remedy this dovetails into another problem that I'm seeing. And I saw this a little bit play out between someone I know and someone I don't know on social media yesterday. I saw one GOP official, and I don't have anything against the GOP official. I mean, they seem nice enough. And someone that I knew from my activist days in St. Louis, who is very much not for Trump, but will choke it down and like vote for the Republican nominee, right? Here's a problem that I'm seeing with this. Let's just say, for the sake of argument, and I say this as somebody, I always tell you where I stand, but I don't tell you how to vote. That's your job to figure that out. It's not, I don't think you should outsource that to any commentator. Trust none of these people. You need to trust your own instincts and you don't want welfare activism. Trust your own instincts over anybody on radio and TV. I'll tell you what I'm doing and why I think the things that I think, but I also think that you need to come to the decisions about things yourselves. So during the primary, I like DeSantis. I mean, I think he's the best Republican governor in the country. I think he's a phenomenal candidate. I think he's everything that conservatives have wanted. Primary didn't work. Primary's been settled. The score was settled at the ballot box, right? You got to move on. And let's just say that the primary ended differently. Let's say that DeSantis was the nominee. There is no way in hell I would be going out there and trying to lord it over people who were against him and trying to further alienate them from the coalition. Because we are, as Republicans, we are not rich in voter turnout. We kill ourselves over voter turnout every single time. Do you know that the majority of the races that Republicans lose, particularly in purple and battleground states, are because Republican turnout is lower than Democrat turnout? That's not a joke. I mean, there's been studies on this. I've analyzed. That's one of the reasons why, you know, they bring me up to New York or whatever, because I can look at this stuff and immediately spot trends. That's a major issue, a major issue. That's the reason we lost the Senate. Interestingly enough, back in 2010, during the midterm elections in which Barack Obama described it as a shellacking, Republican voter turnout was like one of the highest on record. And look at what happened. It was a historic victory. But a lot of stuff plays into this. Voter fatigue is one. But had the primary, like I said, turned out differently, I would be doing everything in my power to be conciliatory towards people who had different choices in the primary. Now, that's not my job. That's just I'm strategizing and thinking I would want as many people to get victory as possible in 2024. I think that a lot of this responsibility, in fact, the responsibility of this falls on Republican officials and campaigns themselves. It is not the voter's job to like you. It is your job to make yourselves likable to the voter. You have to court them. Let's not get this system twisted. This entire country was founded on checking people who are in positions of influence. This entire republic was founded on the premise of only allowing authority by consent of the voter. And it's a temporary authority that has strings attached. And I think that a lot of these Republican Party officials and these campaigns need to realize that. You can't go out there, and I see it. I see a lot of these party heads. They go out into different states, different counties. And they go out and they try to, I think, they're antagonistic, and they You know, they try to, you know, well, are you going to vote for the nominee? Or are you going to, well, of course, you know, they're going to vote for the nominee. Do you need a pledge of fealty? Is that what this is about? You need to stop doing this to people. At some point, this has to stop being a schlong measuring contest. And it's got to be about getting results. And it's got to be about victory in 2024. Because a lot of the stuff that I'm seeing some of these GOP party heads doing and some of these campaign surrogates doing is not helpful for bringing the coalition together. And I told you, during the general, when the general hits, all these suckers become pieces on the chessboard to me. This is a no-feeling zone. What gets me to what I want in 24? I want to win in 24. Who gets me there? What gets me there? What moves get me there? And going out there and holding grudges against people during primaries, that don't get you what you want. And like I said, Republicans are not so rich in voter turnout that they can afford to go out there and throw it around and act like they don't need the votes that they need in order to secure victory in 2024. You need those people. And those people need you. So a lot of people got to make difficult choices. This is about the business of the country. It's not about friends. It's about the business of the country. And I think it's the least sacrifice that someone could make, considering the history of sacrifice to establish this country and defend it. It is the least amount of sacrifice that people could make today to get over themselves and choke back their egos and get together for victory in 24. And that's not too much to ask. So when I see this stuff on social media, it rubs me the wrong way. When I see party leaders doing it, it rubs me the wrong way. I feel like that's an abuse of your influence. And that's not a behavioral trait of a leader. Leaders bring people together. And I think that for the voters, when you see someone being conciliatory and you see them reaching out and doing everything that they can to bring the coalition together, I think that especially because it's show business of the country and we're about winning in 24, if that's what you believe, because you're not a Democrat and you believe that, then I think you got to make the effort too. I mean, again, the least sacrifice people could make. Now, that being said, the polls are too close for my comfort still. And I keep saying that because that, well, it's not 200. It's going to be upwards over $300 million. I mean, keep in mind, Barack Obama, when he ran for re-election, I think he had over $500 million in the war. I'm not kidding. That was their war chest, Democrats' war chest. They're still building it. They haven't even started. They had one ad buy. One. They haven't even started. And I don't want people to be baited into a feeling of complacency. Just be aware of that. Because this is going to start heating up as we roll into summer. And it's going to get nasty. It hadn't even started yet. So I'm saying, reserve your energy. Keep your powder dry. Now, that being said, the RNC needs to help with its. They need to figure out their money problems. For sure. That's something we're going to be talking about coming up. And the cultural issues. We had this piece earlier. We talked about this. This 82-year-old woman who was kicked out of the YMCA pool that she swam in for 40 years because she felt uncomfortable that a man was in the locker room. And this has been happening. This is like the second time that this has happened in a month. Harmeet Dhillon is representing her, and she's going to join us after headlines. Our partners that help bring committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So you guys know the weather rat, the weather priest, they have that rat that sticks its head out the hole and predicts the weather.
It's a groundhog.
Well, it had a baby, Punxsutawney Phil, and its rat wife Phyllis. Oh, they had two babies. So I don't know what their names are. I'm not going to say what Juan suggested. Phil and Phyllis, they live in climate-controlled quarters at the Punxsutawney Memorial Library, and they're going to have a bigger home on the library grounds. And it's not the same Punxsutawney Phil. You know that that rat is, like, has been dead a million times, and they just replace it with one that... I mean, it's a groundhog. You really tell the difference between it? Someone's not going to look at it and go, "That's not Phil!" Anyway, that's... I love that we're a society. I thought we'd have flying cars, but we still have a groundhog that predicts the weather. I love it. I mean, I'm not bashing it, so don't get me wrong. I think these sort of weird things, this is why aliens are like, okay, maybe they're somewhat redeemable. I don't know. moving on. Houston mayor, Democrat-run city, says his city's broke because they couldn't stop spending money that wasn't theirs. He says they're broke. They can't pay their firefighters. Mayor John Whitmire is proposing a 5% cut across the board except for fire and police. Tax hikes and increased fees for parking and city services are likely next. But he was elected in December. They've been that city's been Democrat run for how long has Houston been around?
Never.
Yeah. And are you shocked? They're broke. They don't stop spending money. They're broke. A U.S. intel agency, we're going to talk more about this coming up, wants to ban the terms radical Islamist and jihadist because it's hurtful to the feelings of jihadists and radical Islamists. According to the Washington Free Beacon, the Office of the Director of National Intelligence is also instructing employees to not use the words cakewalk for some reason, sanity check, or blacklisted. And they said, yes, spies cannot use the biased language like radical Islamists and jihadists. I think the Office of the Director of National Intelligence needs to be entirely disbanded, dissolved and disbanded. You can't say brown bag. You can't say grandfathered. Cakewalk is said to be a dance performed by slaves for slave owners on plantation. Brown bag refers to something within the African-American community. I mean, it couldn't be the fact that that's a bag that people carry their lunch in forever. Come on. Where's the sweet meteor of death? I hope it hits that place first. We have a lot more on the way, including coming up, Harmeet Dhillon on this story of this 82-year-old banned from YMCA. She didn't want a man in the locker room with her. Stay with us.
Whether you're a policy wonk, a news junkie, or simply someone hungry for insightful discourse, the Dana Show podcast has your back. Follow Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Welcome back to the program. You can listen coast to coast on a station near you. You can stream the radio program as well and follow along with the simulcast, Channel 347 DirecTV, also on X, YouTube, Facebook, Rumble, everywhere else. So this story, we talked about this story a couple of days ago, and this follows the Planet Fitness story of a woman who saw a man shaving in the women's bathroom in the women's sink. This story has to do with 82-year-old Julie Jamin, who is seeking an apology because she was banned from a pool that she swam in for 40 years. YMCA, the C, YMCA. Because she was in the shower, she heard a man's voice. She peeks out because, you know, you're in the women's locker room, you're in the shower, vulnerable place for a woman. She hears a man's voice, and she sees a man in a woman's swimsuit watching two little girls get ready to use the restroom. Now, she thinks, I think what most women would immediately assume, is this a crime happening? Am I watching a crime unfolding right now? This looks predatory. And so she asked if the guy had a male copulatory organ, and then it went from there. So apparently he was with the YMCA, even though he had no badge or any kind of identification indicating such. There was no signage outside saying the bathroom was open to men as well as women. And she was the one, this 82-year-old woman was the one who was penalized, not the guy. Joining us is her attorney, legal titan, Harmeet Dhillon. She's joining us via Skype, and you know Harmeet, you've seen her everywhere, and she takes all these tough cases. Harmeet, it's so good to have you. This case is insane to me, because I got to tell you, honestly, if I was in the women's locker room, first off, that's a very vulnerable time. You know, women, you know, you're undressing, you're taking a shower after, you know, swimming, working out. I hear a man's voice. I look outside and see him watching two little girls with whom he apparently has zero familial relationship with, getting ready to use the restroom. I would also wonder if I'm not witnessing a crime underway. That was her initial reaction. That seems perfectly reasonable, but the YMCA said no.
Absolutely. Well, we're seeing a rash of this type of incident, Dana, and it's really troubling because we women, like you said, first of all, we are trained to protect ourselves. But secondly, we're trained to look out for others. And many women who are professionals in a field, including teaching or the healthcare field, we're actually under our duty to report this type of incident happening to vulnerable girls. And so when this woman who did the exact right thing is being penalized without due process, this is a real problem because, first of all, this pool is on the property of the city of Port Townsend in Washington State, a beautiful location, and she's used it for 40 years. It's currently leased out to the YMCA Young Men's Christian Association. And so you cannot deprive somebody of their property right and property taxpayer to use public property without due process. So the Y has a problem. The city of Port Townsend has a problem. And frankly, this policy is problematic. And in response to our clients, you know, outrage over this incident and the whole back and forth with management over there, they said, well, you know, of course you should have known that we're letting men into the women's locker room now because we're flying a pride flag in the lobby. And that's supposed to be some kind of a legal notice. No, actually, I think a lot of you know, gay people would agree that this type of an encounter is really problematic. And so the rules keep changing, Dana, and in any event, the constitutional rules haven't changed. And Julie can't be deprived of her rights without due process. So we're looking forward to the why and the city's response. And if it's not satisfactory, we will sue them.
That's a great point, too, about the property and who's leasing it and who it's owned by. I mean, she is a taxpayer, talking with Harmeet Dhillon, who's joining us via Skype. And the flag, too, that's not a legal notice. And I was always told by the left, this is what we've heard from the trans activists, that it's not an indication of whom you're attracted to, but how you identify. So that doesn't necessarily mean that a guy who wants to identify as a woman is still not attracted to women, which creates a problem in the women's locker room that apparently they just didn't pay attention to with this whole thing. Because the way that I understood it, it was just the basic pride flag, and it didn't have the trans, I think, triangle and all of that on it.
Well, even if it did, Julie's 82 years old. Yeah. I'm, you know, of a certain age. So are you. Like, how are we supposed to figure out what these flags mean? And do they mean there are going to be men with penises in our women's spaces. This is completely inappropriate. It's inappropriate. And, you know, no amount of notice or a signage would make this appropriate, in my opinion.
And what floors me, and this is what I don't understand, Harmeet, if a man who wants to identify as a woman feels uncomfortable in the men's locker room and he wants to use the women's locker room, he's accommodated. Oh, he feels uncomfortable. He feels unsafe. We'll let him access the women's locker room. But if a woman feels uncomfortable and unsafe because a man is in the women's locker room, she's called a bigot. I mean, that seems like accommodation of one over the other. And in the scenario that the context that you just put out there with the taxpayer funded facility, that's a no-go.
Absolutely. So we really need the courts to clarify these situations. And you know, we are seeing it in so many different contexts, Dana. We're seeing it in women's sports. We're seeing it in women's athletics in the collegiate level, which is protected by Title IX. And so currently all the rights that the feminists, who are themselves Julie's age, fought for have been taken away in the space of a handful of years, to the point where women are the ones who are being asked to feel uncomfortable everywhere we go. And we're the ones who are physically vulnerable. We're typically smaller in size than men. We're less strong than men. And I don't think, for one, as a woman who's fought for my rights in the workplace and in society, that I need to stand for it. Neither is Julie. So we're really proud to stand up for her. And we need to have the court step in and put an end to this and give back women their protected spaces.
We're talking about the story of 82-year-old Julie Jamin, who was kicked out of the YMCA band after using a pool for 40 years because she called out a man who was in the women's locker room. Harmeet, women are told, I was trying to remember, I think I've grown up with this. I don't know when I first was told to listen to my gut. Listen to my gut instinct. If you feel uncomfortable or unsafe in a situation, you know, seek help or try to remove yourself from the situation. Women are told, you know, these are things that you need to look out for. If you feel uncomfortable, you see a strange man you don't know walking down the street towards you, maybe cross the street, go to the other, you know, the opposite sidewalk. I mean, we're told these things because there are certain statistics that justify the need for that concern. What does this sort of behavior, this shaming of women who are relying on that gut instinct that we've been brought up with for generations, what does that do to women and our self-preservation when we're shamed for relying on those instincts?
Well, first of all, younger women who don't have the same training that we do and are being told that this is perfectly normal are going to be at higher risk of sexual assault. That's a fact. They're going to be at higher risk of physical injury in the sports context. That's a biological fact. This confusion is really a one-way ratchet. It's in favor of men and it's against women. And every woman needs to stand up and shout about this because our rights are being eroded and our safety is being eroded. I mean, to the point where women who might have passed a bad check or done something wrong in their private lives and got convicted of a crime, the federal prisons are mandating that women be housed with men who are identifying as women, even if all of their physical organs are intact and they're going quote unquote process for my taxpayer expense. This is leading to sexual assaults of women prisoners. And so I view this as a 5-alarm fire. This is an epidemic in women's safety and women's rights. And, you know, regardless of your political orientation, and I'm glad to see women, at least women sports leaders, Gina Navratilova and others, some women feminists, are standing up and calling this what it is, but they need to be joined by the rest of them. And this seems like a conspiracy yet again of men trying to take away women's prerogatives and rights. And this is, we should not stand.
That's a great point. I mean, it's the ultimate victory of the progressive patriarchy, and somehow they've gotten some of these third wave feminists to go along with it and accommodate it. We're going to watch this case and see how this unfolds. I'm so glad that you're on it because I feel confident that it will be resolved favorably and in favor of women with you handling this. Harmeet Dhillon, always appreciate your fight. And thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
Of course. We'll have more to come. And of course, we'll watch this case of 82-year-old Julie Jamin. This is just, I mean, 40 years she uses this pool. And she's, I mean, I got to tell you, and to that point, I think it's not just a woman either. I think if a man were to see something like this, he would say, wait, hold up. This doesn't seem right. And it's not really even just a woman that would, even a man, if he were to see a man in a woman's bathing suit, and it was, you know, in the women's locker room or somewhere else, or trying to watch, you know, watching a 4-year-old and a 6-year-old girl try to use the bathroom, your antenna would go up. You would be suspicious. There would be alarm bells in your head. And it's not even just limited to a woman's concern thing. And that's what, when they accused Jamin of being bigoted, I mean, on the face of what she saw, that looked suspicious. And imagine how she or you would feel if you saw something like that and you didn't do anything because you were worried about being called a bigot, or you were worried about being banned from a pool or ostracized from your community, and something horrific happened. The children were victimized or trafficked or, what I mean, you know, assaulted. I can't even think. Imagine what the feeling would be if you knew you could have prevented it and you didn't because you were worried about being ostracized or shamed by an ideology that doesn't think about that. They only think about accommodating the immediate. It's sad and it's sickening. We have Florida Man on the way as we move our partners that help. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
It's his life mission to make bad decisions. It's time for Florida Man.
A Winter Haven, Florida man's hankering for beef jerky and pistachio nuts was so strong that he stole more than $100 worth of it from a Polk County convenience store and didn't pay. From Fox 13 News, surveillance video shows Anton Karimfilov, a little awkward, okay, whatever, of Windmere, walking into a Love's truck stop, looking at a sign depicting a deputy patrol car that read, "Free ride if you shoplift from the store." He stopped to look at it. He legit was on camera looking at it. And then he walked in the store, grabbed beef jerky and pistachios, and then left. And he was literally, the employees saw him steal them, so they went to stop him, and he ran to his Lowe's box truck. So apparently he drove for Lowe's. He was charged with first-degree petty theft. Imagine going, having that charge over nuts and jerky. And also, how much jerky and nuts did he take that it was $100? Because it looked like he just swiped it. I mean, I get it that inflation's out of control, but is it? Yeah. I haven't bought, like, pistachios in a long time.
It's pretty expensive.
I haven't bought pistachios in a long time because I'm terrified to buy pistachios. So that's why I was wondering. I'm like, did he take like two pistachios and it was $100? I'm wondering. Good heavens. So a, let's do this guy. This Florida man was identified following an ATV chase that spanned Miami-Dade and Broward counties. 18-year-old Anthony Perez. It only stopped because he ran out of gas. He was wearing a ski mask. He grabbed an ATV and jumped on the Northbound Express lane of I-95. Officers joined the chase. He slowed down at some point, sped up, evaded officers, then got off the highway, and then he made a U-turn. And then he started slowing down because he legit ran out of gas. He was taken into custody. Can you imagine? How far did you think you were going to get on that, dude? Like, for real, how far did you think you were going to get? A Florida man says that he had to pay $1,000 to get his pet turtle back. Tortoise, sorry. Merrick Westland came home from work to find his 18-year-old tortoise was tortoise-napped? Yeah. He's upset. He's pursuing potential legal action. And he says that it's an 18-year-old African sulcata tortoise named Shelby. He posted signs around the neighborhood, all this stuff. He actually thinks that the tortoise broke out of the enclosure and ran through the fence in his backyard. Tortoise.
That's what they do.
Yeah, they run. And he says that he thinks a wildlife place had his tortoise. And it was Wildlife Rescue and Rehabilitation. And they did have her. And they demanded that he pay $1,000 to get her back. The Pinellas County Sheriff's Office says they consider it a civil matter. He had to pay $1,000. Because apparently Wildlife Rescue and Rehabilitation, that's Wildlife Rescue and Rehabilitation in Seminole, Florida, website WRRFL.org, because they were holding, apparently, sounds like they were holding the tortoise hostage until the guy coughed up $1,000. You all sound shady as all get out. Wildlife Rescue and Rehab in Seminole, Florida. That's Wildlife Rescue and Rehab in Seminole, Florida, off of 82nd Avenue.
What was that website?
The website to Wildlife Rescue and Rehab in Seminole, Florida at WRRFL.org, WRRFL.org, in case you want to leave a nice civil message about stealing people's turtles. Tortoises, whatever. I hate that stuff. Like, you just shook that dude down for $1,000. You guys are fruitcakes. A Florida woman was accused of flipping off deputies while driving erratically on the grass. Just another day in woman driving. A Florida woman is accused, this is Key West. The deputies were trying to pull her over. Darla Vidal, 35. She's facing a felony count of resisting a police officer and one misdemeanor count of resisting an officer following this incident. I guess she's just not getting charged. It was March 16th. But it started when a deputy observed her driving a car on the grass at high rate of speed. She didn't stop when the officers were like, "Whoa!" with the lights. And at one point, she waved her middle finger at the deputy trying to pull her over. And while she did, she almost hit a deer. But then she stopped later on Pensacola Road and ran towards the deputy screaming, "I hate the police." She would not stop. They kept saying, "We're going to shoot you if you keep resisting arrest." She was booked into Monroe County Jail. As she was flipping them off, she almost hit a deer First off, what was that deer doing out there? I mean, you sneeze and they run away. I mean, you look at them and they run away. Just saying. A man was killed while test driving a motorcycle outside of a Harley-Davidson dealer in Titusville, say police. He crashed his motorcycle literally into the wall of a Titusville shopping center while test driving it on Monday afternoon. That's sad. It was Miracle City Harley-Davidson. And they said that he just lost control and crashed into the back wall of the shopping center. That's horrible. Golly, we have more in store. Another hour on the way. Stick with us.
Y'all ever wondered what a 500-foot roll of inch and a quarter pecs looks like?
Look at them cicadas.
And if you want to know how fun it is to unroll this mess, not very. Especially when it's, you know, 100 freaking degrees out here in South Alabama, but at least the heat will help it straighten out. Appreciate y'all.
So I don't even know who this chick is. Her name is Hannah. And she's Hannah Barron. She's, you know, on TikTok. And she's helping to build a house. Her house. Her own house. On TikTok. She doesn't have a Twitter account. And, you know, she's a hard worker. She's pretty. She's young. She has a shirt that has a rifle on it in one of the videos, so I know she supports 2A. And for some reason, some of these, like, fake, they call themselves, like, trad right. I think that they're fake accounts that are manufactured. It's a psyop to divide the right. I really do believe this. And then one of the things that went viral was some chick from Lebanon who apparently cosplays as an American conservative. I don't know. And I'm not going to make her famous. But she went off on this Hannah chick and American women. She said, quote, "This accent needs to be illegal and women should be banned from doing manual labor like this. There is nothing feminine about American women. American women are literally men." So I took a look at this lady's Twitter account, the lady who was criticizing Hannah. And she's one of those who, like, her eyebrows are gradients, you know. She does the contouring and she wears so much makeup. She looks kind of like a lunchtime drag queen. And I had said on Twitter, I wrote, "I'm not listening to engagement criticism about Southern women's accents from any female who wears enough pancake makeup to run her own printing press with just her face and a stack of clean pillowcases." Which is true. If I have to do a neck check on you, girl, then you don't need to be talking about anybody else's femininity. There is too much. My grandmother always said, and I know that this is a statement, a quote that she didn't make up, but she just repeated it. Makeup should be a secret between a woman and her mirror. She shouldn't be an entire palette from Sephora. She didn't add the Sephora part, I did. I mean, we should not know that you did a gradient on your eyebrows, right? You should not be wearing so much rouge on your cheeks that I can probably do like a sample of it, take it to Sephora and they could paint match it like they could at Home Depot. Shouldn't have to do that. And for anyone who has never heard Southern women speak, especially if you're from Southern Alabama, that's how Southern Alabama people speak. And there's nothing wrong with it. I mean, I'm sorry that you don't look like you have enough arm muscles to, like, even butter toast. But, you know, that doesn't mean that a woman who can help build her own house is somehow unfeminine. I want to know who these jackwagons are that they think that they have the patent on defining who is or who is not feminine. Because I will tell you one thing that I see all these other engagement clout chasers who are running down this Hannah Barron, one thing that they lack that she doesn't, and it is a very important qualification for ladies and femininity, and that is class. I found that absolutely fascinating, that whole thing. And I just, it amazes me that that became like a huge debate over the weekend, end of last week and this weekend. And why are we taking, I'm sorry, a foreigner, a foreign woman's, who not, I don't even think is a citizen, probably can't even vote here. Your opinion on American women? Let's see. I don't have to ask my husband for permission to own a firearm. I don't have to cover up the beauty that God created on me. I don't have to do any of that stuff. So I think maybe, you know, do a self-check along with a neck check.
The Dana Show.
Everybody's going to go into adrenal exhaustion with the way that some of these people are covering this stuff. And they do it for clicks. That's what ticks me off. When you F.A., you're going to F.O. A consequence of busting up into a country, kidnapping the kids, kidnapping the wives, and, you know, generally being terrorist thugs, is that you might have your place of origin temporarily turned into absolute glass.
The Dana Show.
So, like on, you know, so many issues, what New York does, what California does, Florida will do the opposite. And so the squatter scam ends today with our legislation. And it's important because, Sean, you know, now being a Florida resident, we've got people that will be here for 7 months of the year and then they'll go to Michigan, right, or New York or even Canada. So what? You come back after the summer and someone's in your house and then they just get to stay there for 6 months. Now in Florida, you call up, you fill out a form, sheriff comes, and the sheriff kicks them out of your property.
I love that. I can't even believe squatter's rights is a phrase. You don't got no rights. You're a squatter. Stop. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash here with you. Top of this third hour. Listen coast to coast. Find us YouTube, Facebook. Always good discussion over there. Channel 347, DirecTV, X as well. So the property rights law, that's what it is, was signed. I mean, that it has to be affirmed like that just shows you how widespread of a problem this is. There's been a number of cases. You've had a Los Angeles home that was squatted. Squatters who murdered a family in New York City to take over their house. So the Burbs, remember I gave you guys an assignment some months ago and I said you need to watch a movie called The Burbs. It was done in the late 80s, I think. And I remember my mom taking me to the theater to see it. And the whole family can watch it. It is, I think, one of the funniest movies ever made. Bruce Dern's character in this is hysterical. Carrie Fisher's in it, Bruce Dern, Tom Hanks, bunch of, you know, other. Bruce Dern's my absolute favorite, though. And it's about, Corey Feldman's in it, back when he was still Cool Corey. And it's about this neighborhood on a cul-de-sac, you know, this cul-de-sac's out, and the neighbors know each other, they're friends. It's back when people used to talk to each other. But this weird family, the Klopeks, move in next door to Tom Hanks' character. And the family that lived in the house just disappeared, you know, they moved apparently, but nobody recalls ever seeing a moving truck out there. And the story, the movie gets into what happens when the cul-de-sac folks meet the Klopeks. And it's interesting because their house went all downhill. It was like the dirt yard. It was just horrible. And so I feel like, you know, that's like an ultimate squatters movie, feels like. I'm not giving anything away, but I'm just telling you. It's like it is. You should watch it if you haven't already. It's so good. But the fact that you have to have another law to affirm what I really, I mean, it should be obvious. So, I don't know. The whole thing is wild to me. And speaking of Law and Order, let me pull some of this up. And squatting in New York. So this had to do, I keep seeing these videos. Like there have been even like celebrities that have, what's that one chick's name? Bethany Frankel or whatever. I don't know what she does, but she's famous for something. I literally have no idea what she does. One of my friends will tell me. I don't know. I literally don't know what she does. I think she makes a wine. That's all I think. I don't know. Anyway, long story short, apparently she got hit in the face randomly in New York. There was a bunch of other videos where these women were just randomly, different women, different parts of New York, randomly hit in the face. And so now the Women's New York City Caucus comes out and they said that they are deeply disturbed and concerned about widespread reports of attacks against women in New York City that have been confirmed by the NYPD. And they're asking the NYPD for an immediate and comprehensive investigation with transparent updates to the public. Do you know why men aren't helping? Because somebody retweeted it and said why it was a council member, a city council member in New York retweeted it and said, why aren't men speaking out, or where are the men speaking out? Yeah, where are all the men calling this out? Y'all jail them. You arrest people like Daniel Penny or the bodega owner. I mean, you teach people to not defend themselves. We were just talking, you know, last hour with Harmy Dillon over the woman who got kicked out of the YMCA, the pool that she went to for 40 years because she had had raised concern about a man being in the women's locker room. When you're not jailing them, you're shaming women for instincts. But you're told there it's been an attack on self-defense, not just with firearms, but just on the basic act of trying to preserve your life. There's been a major attack on this. I just cannot believe. They're like, well, I cannot believe this woman. Where are the men calling this out? Wow. You know why? I mean, do you remember the last man that stood up to try to defend other women? His name is Daniel Penny. You had that Jordan Neely on the subway platform who was threatening to stab and kill the women on the subway. And Daniel Penny, when it got real bad, and because he had already punched, Jordan Neely already punched another woman in the face, an elderly woman, and broke her nose and her orbital bone and her jaw and all this stuff. Like, he bashed her in the head. He tried shoving another woman, according to another report, onto the subway tracks. He was so violent. Again, some of you already know this. There was a subreddit that was confirmed by NYPD. It was a subreddit about Jordan Neely warning people, watch out for this violent guy on this platform. And this, you know, he was well known to be super violent. And the media was like, well, he impersonated Michael Jackson 10 years ago. He's so innocent. His family was nowhere around until there was money to be made off of him. And he was on that subway platform threatening people. There were several women that spoke to media outlets, and they were there, and they said they were scared for their lives. And Daniel Penny stood up and he neutralized it. And so they arrested him. And they're trying to ruin his life and throw him in jail forever. That's why more people don't speak up. You don't get to have it both ways. You need to pick what you want. And half the time, all these women have been decrying men defending women as toxic masculinity. I thought y'all were badass third wave feminists. Hey, girl, take care of your own business. Thought y'all were tough. Female empowerment and all that jazz, right? Oh, now you need a man to speak out after you've been demonizing them for how long? Why in the hell would a man want to speak out for you? Calling them toxic? Ridiculing them? Demonizing them? Councilmember Amanda Farias, Council District 18. You know, she's not alone on the city council to share that sentiment. She's not there by herself with it. She retweets this stuff. Oh, our Women's History Month. Love our Women's History Month. Well, you're so empowered. Defend your own damn self. She had said, quote, I continue to be heartbroken and outraged. This is May 11th, 23. I continue to be heartbroken and outraged by the death of Jordan Neely and the lack of justice. Lack of justice? According to this New York City Council member's idea of justice, women should just get punched in the face. Don't expect anyone, you know, you owe it to the man trying to attack you. Just get punched. That's the message that they're imparting. This is what I get so mad about. I'm so tired of dudes being attacked. Do you know why I'm so tired of men being attacked? Because I have to get aggressive. I don't want to be aggressive. Do you know why you have a bunch of more aggressive women, especially on the right, anymore? Because they're tired of the crap that they're seeing from women on the left. My husband can't hit a chick, but I can. We've seen this time and time again. We're seeing it in gaming right now with Gamergate 2.0. There's some game bunny that's over on BBC. She's a presenter. She was out there defending Sweet Baby Inc., which is, first off, don't glass over. Don't be like, oh, I don't play games. This is doesn't bother me. It bothers you. It affects you whether you know it or not. You don't have to play video games, which are not bad, by the way. You don't have to play video games to understand that this is a major, major escape for men and some women today. Of all ages, to get away from all of the garbage that's in our society. I am a casual player. I like playing first-person shooter. I like horror games. I love it because it's an escape. I actually am relaxed when I play. I have a lot of fun with it. I don't care if I don't have, you know, a character that looks like me. I literally did a character build as an Ogryn in Darktide, so I clearly don't care. It's about the story, it's about the ability of the character, and it's about the strategy when you're playing with other people. And I don't even necessarily like to know, like for people who are playing with me to know who I am or that I'm a woman. Because I just want the gameplay. But the Sweet Baby Inc. is one of these stupid DEI firms that all of these other developers are being forced to hire. And there's a ton of these Sweet Baby Inc. things. And they oversee the scripts for the games and the characters and the roleplay, and they wokeify it. So all of these people who have had, you know, all of this fun with gameplay, now you have the CRT DEI woke scold Karens coming in saying, oh, well, we want to be represented. Well, then make your own damn game. They did, by the way. The first Gamergate, some boring broad made a game about depression. It was the stupidest damn thing I've ever seen. And then she got mad and blamed all the men when nobody wanted to play her stupid game. And then she was accused, and it seems like it's justifiably so, of screwing for positive reviews. That's the truth. So you get these game bunnies out there that get into these positions of authority, whether it's at gaming publications or this one chick who's a presenter for the BBC. And she says that everybody who disagrees with woke theology needs to be purged. Bitch, I'm in Dallas. Come at me. I am so tired of this stuff. This is what I'm talking about. This is why women like me hate chicks like this. Because you force me to be aggressive, which I feel like is against my female nature. As a woman, I don't feel that women should have to be aggressive like this, particularly if we don't want to. But the culture is increasingly making us so, because we have these third wave broads out there that are neutralizing the strength of men, and they're calling masculinity toxic. In response to that, to protect the men in my family, I have to turn into a raging bitch in order to push back against it. And I'm really good at it. And I shouldn't be. And that makes me madder. Do you get my point? I'm so tired of all of this stuff. If you want to create your stupid Barbie games, go do it. Leave everybody else alone. We don't have to agree with you. I don't need trans characters in my gameplay. Stop being obsessed with sex, you freaks. Stop it. Can we just have an escape from your stupid garbage for like 5 seconds, please? I'm not asking, I'm telling you. We're going to have an escape from your stupid garbage. And this is why you need to be interested in what is happening with games and development of games. Because as much as you don't think so, it is an amazing form of information distribution. It is the modern day putting all the bikes on the front lawn and going to your friend's house. It is a means, a mode. Just because it's unfamiliar to you doesn't mean that it's synthetic. It is real. And I get so aggravated about this. I think dudes need their spaces. I think women need their spaces. I think gaming, while, and by the way, it's not white dudes that play it like this broad at the BBC thinks. It's actually the majority of game players are Asian men. The women play it too. Women, not every chick does. Some of my girlfriends they look at me like I'm a Martian if I talk to them about it. But I enjoy it. I think it's fun. It's just one of the things I casually do. I bring this up. My son was telling me Helldivers 2, the developer there has been pushing back against the insistence, including the alphabet stuff in Helldivers 2. And they've been going at Discord discussions. Discord is like a place where you can chat while you're gaming and share mods and all this other stuff. And all the woke scolds are going after everything. And the Helldivers 2 developer was like, yeah, no, we're not doing this stuff. It's one of the reasons why I like Darktide, because they don't buy into this stuff either. They're like, no, we're doing a game. You either want to play or you don't. Warhammer's, they're not getting into all that stuff. I appreciate that because I feel like you can focus on the game instead of all this other accessory stuff. But I got to tell you, I'm at my limit with this. I really am. I'm at my limit with this third wave stuff. And coming up, I'm going to tell you why I get really mad at some of these fake trad wannabe people, like some of these chicks that I see who are pretending to be super right folks. They are single, childless. They've literally contributed nothing to the human species or our culture at all whatsoever. But they think that they can enthrall society with their stupid, uneducated hot takes and that they are owed an audience and you're not. So we'll have more on that coming up. As we move towards committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
Most U.S. troops are not getting enough sleep, according to a new report from the Washington Times. They're saying that these troops, they're not, I mean, you're supposed to get 8 hours of sleep a night, right? But apparently that's not happening at all. It was the GAO, Government Accountability Office. It was a new study that came out, and they found a sizable majority of service members actually get six or fewer hours of sleep each night, whereas the DOD recommends a minimum of 7 hours. And they said, obviously, you know, fatigue affects performance, et cetera, et cetera. You can jack people up on amphetamines all you want to, but it's still going to affect performance. The study was made public this week, and they did it after they were looking at how a remotely piloted aircraft operator had said that they almost collided with another due to mental fatigue. So now they're looking into it. It's another big problem. Subaru is recalling over 118,000 vehicles over an airbag issue. I thought it was just because they were Subarus. Sacramento says it's a sanctuary for transgender people. No one cares. No one cares. No one cares. Oh, my gosh. We got more on the way. Don't go anywhere. Now, speaking of trans tyranny, you guys know Cherry Curry, right? And if you don't, why? The Runaways, one of my absolute favorite bands because it was a girl rock band and they just pioneered girl rock. And there are a lot of women today that are in rock and roll or people who like women in rock and roll that owe a debt of gratitude to Cherry Curry. She was the singer, right? So she got canceled by trans tyrants at the ironically named Riot Girl Festival in Bisbee, Arizona. They canceled her because she spoke out against the grooming of kids and targeting of kids with trans surgeries. The Riot Girl Festival. That whole festival wouldn't exist without people like Cherry Curry. All of these remedial power chord playing bitches can only have a space in the musical sphere because Curry blazed the path for you. People like Susie Quattro, people like Sherry Curry, people like Lita Ford. So bow down and give thanks. I just find that incredibly asinine. Yeah, she opposed the transitioning of minors. She's like, if you're an adult, and she's even like more to the left of a lot of conservatives on the issue. She's like, if you're an adult, you choose to do this with your own dollars. That's one thing. She's like, but if you're a child, how? And I agree with the reasoning that it's not informed consent. It isn't informed consent. You're pumping people full of hormones. That I'm going to tell you, I had an aunt. I don't want to give anybody's names. Who, when she went through menopause, they did all the hormone stuff with her. She ended up developing a serious health issue because of that. They have no idea. There are no long-term studies on this stuff. You're just jacking kids up with hormones to hell with the consequences they're going to have to deal with a decade down the road. Big Pharma's like, yeah. That's not informed consent. And so they're actually canceling her. From the Riot Girl Festival. That's one of the funniest things I've ever heard of. Because that whole thing, if you know that term, like took off like early 90s. And that was, it was like L7 and really, you know, hard, grungy, guitar-driven rock. I mean, there were like a bunch of bands that were there. But you have like a lot of these new chicks that are out. And I'm like, how are you canceling this icon? And some of the chicks that got big in the 90s, how are you canceling an icon like this? You either want to protect kids or you don't. She's saying, can we protect kids from this? This isn't informed consent. She's 1,000% correct. And I think it's incredibly brave for her to go out and say stuff like this, especially in this environment. There is nothing more metal or punk rock than what she just did. And she's not stepping down. She's not backing down off it either. She is an absolute icon. If you think you're going to sit here and make Cherry Curry back down from something, you're a moron. You have no concept of this lady's history. She's a chainsaw artist, for crying out loud. You think that she's got time for your stupid political sensitivities about grooming kids? Kane, who the hell are these people think they are?
I don't know.
The whole reason I ever picked up a guitar, I play rhythm guitar horribly, and I can play drums. The only reason I ever did was because people like Sherry Curry. I had a Runaways t-shirt that I still have. You don't believe me? Check my Twitter. True story. Golly. Instead of like complaining about her performing somewhere, I would be punching chicks in the neck to be first in line to get a ticket to be front row to see her. And she's absolutely 1,000% right. You know, pointing out that kids should be protected from this hormonal experimentation. And that's exactly what it is, because there are zero long-term studies. It is so dangerous. Kids that are still going through puberty that haven't even fully formed yet. Oh my gosh, this is so dangerous. That's not care and it's not informed consent. And she's right.
Looking for the drive-through version of The Dana Show? Check out the best highlights from every show and Dana's Absurd Truth podcast, posted daily from The Dana Show.
And what they mean by DEI, in my opinion, is duly elected incumbent. We know what they want to say, but they don't have the courage to say the N-word. And the fact that I don't believe in their untruthful and wrong ideology, and I am very proud of my heritage and who I am and where I come from, scares them, because me being at my position means that their way of thinking, their way of life, of being comfortable and suffering, and while everyone else suffers, is going to be at risk, and they should be afraid, because that's my purpose in life.
Oh, for the love. So, just when stupid comments give openings, this is Baltimore Mayor Brandon Scott, and he was on with the chick who scalped the Karen, Joy Karen, that chick on MSNBC. I don't know, I don't watch these shows. Welcome back, Dana Lash with you. So Brandon Scott, he's the mayor of Baltimore, and he was responding to this post on Twitter. And I love it how people take literally like randos on social media. It's an anonymous account on social media, right? And they take these accounts and they make them like the de facto representation of the entire right. I don't even know. I've never even seen this account. But this account said, this is Baltimore's DEI mayor commenting on the collapsed Francis Scott Key Bridge. And so you had, it was a clip of Scott, and this person retweeted it and said that. It's just like rando. I don't even know what this is. And MSNBC made like an entire whole thing about it. Like it's, and then they had one congressional candidate, one Anthony Sabatini, who retweeted a video of the bridge falling, and he wrote, DEI did this. Shut up. I'm so tired of this. If you're going to use the term, use it right. Don't, you know, boy cries wolf it until no one takes you seriously because you sucked all of the justification and legitimacy out of the term. DEI is a real thing. I'm pretty sure I don't like Brandon Scott. I'm pretty sure that he's like a total commie. I'm also pretty sure he didn't build the bridge. Right? Pretty sure he hadn't even been elected long enough to do any of that. And he, that's the other thing. He was elected with 70% of the vote. If you're DEI hire, that means that you are hired to check an identity politic box. That means you're hired because you have a vagina or because the color of your skin or because you tuck and you have a weird flag. That's you hiring based on that. That's a DEI hire. This dude was elected. Use these terms properly or don't use them at all because you make all of our jobs harder and we all got enough stuff to deal with all the stupidity out there without these thirsty goofballs trying to do some stupid hot take and say, oh, you don't even know what DEI is then. And you hurt our cause. You hurt our fight against it. You hurt our side. And then you give him the opportunity to go and play the sad violin on MSNBC. That's so dumb. I mean, and then you make Joy Reid look like she's making a point. Oh my gosh. No, he's not a DEI mayor. He's just a bad Democrat mayor, like every other Democrat mayor. They all suck. You don't even have to say DEI. The better thing to say was, wow, maybe the Democrats that have generationally run that city, maybe let's pay attention to some of this stuff. Let's look at, you know, what control we have over the upkeep of certain vessels coming through, or if it's an infrastructure thing. Maybe Democrats can check out the infrastructure. Their record's not so good with this stuff. I mean, there's a lot of things that you could say about generationally run Democrat cities, none of which have anything to do with DEI. But I just, that makes me mad when I see this stuff. I'm like, you just made it harder for everybody else. Everybody else. But I get aggravated because those are the only two, apparently, I guess, right-leaning people that they made a whole thing about this. They had this candidate guy and then this rando on Twitter. Oh, here's the entire right. Have you noticed how they do that? It's the entirety of the right. One of the other things that I saw, I don't know why it made me think of this, and I'm going to get to some of this other stuff. Who was it? Where was he speaking? It was Kyle Rittenhouse. He was speaking at an event. Where was he at? He was at some event. No, it was not Kentucky. He was not speaking at a university in Kentucky. Where was it? Because there were all these activists. There were black activists outside of the building where Rittenhouse was going in, where he was going to go in to speak.
Western Kentucky. Oh,
for the love. And they were like yelling and weren't they calling him a racist and all this other stuff?
Yeah.
Can I ask a real, just now some of you is going to be really, yeah, I know the answer to this. I know y'all know the answer to this, but Kane, I feel like the people protesting and calling him a racist don't know the answer to this. Pray tell, what were the races of the people that he shot in self-defense?
Let's see, every single, yeah, that's white.
Oh,
yeah.
The convicted kid toucher was white.
Yeah,
the convicted woman beater was white.
Yep.
And the convicted domestic abuser was white.
Yep.
By the way, all of them ineligible to carry.
Yep.
And one of them was trying to kill Rittenhouse with a skateboard. The other, didn't he beat up his grandma? Mm. That gross. Two of them were killed. One of them was injured. The one guy, didn't he beat up his grandma? He pulled a gun, because he sucked at handling a gun, he FA'd and FO'd.
Yeah.
I mean, you pull a gun on me in a situation like that, I'll blow your damn head off. I mean, he's lucky he got shot in the hand. And then he tried to, I meant to kill this minor, but I ended up, not knowing how to actually pull my gun because I never trained. I just carried it to pretend to be a hard ass and I got shot in the hand. Anyway, my whole point of bringing this up is that they were white. Why is the left saying that he shot black people? I'm mystified by this. The left is so partisan and so ridiculously, zealously partisan. They will literally make up something and convince themselves of it. They were calling him a racist at this thing. And I'm like, wait, hold up. Those white dudes weren't they burning down black businesses?
Yeah, they were all part of it.
I don't know. We've already passed the point where logic applies, and we are now in the Star Wars cantina of society, where up is down, black is white. It's like the Star Wars cantina of society and the tunnel that Willy Wonka drove the kids through, all together, in one reality. That's where we're at. Golly, I just wanted to add, I just wanted to clarify that because I feel like I don't know. 60 Minutes has this interview with the president of Mexico, guys. He's got a proposal for stemming the illegal immigration. Have you heard about his proposal? Let me tell you what he's offering, Kane. He's not offering anything. He is asking for some things. He wants the U.S. to pay off these other countries $20 billion a year. Ask the Romans how that worked out with the Huns. He wants the U.S. to commit $20 billion a year to Latin American countries and countries in the Caribbean, lift all the sanctions on Venezuela, end the Cuban embargo. Oh, and all Mexicans that illegally entered the country should be legalized. Let's see.
Is it November yet? Or?
No, it's not.
Not yet.
How do you sit across the table from him and he's making that offer to you? How? This is why I can't ever be allowed near elected office. Because I think I would have, you know, sat there, nodded, and listened to his demands. And then leaned across the table and just very calmly said, how about you go do something unflattering to yourself? And they got up and, you know, had some quesadillas or some tamales or something. You know what I'm saying? Who asks that? Who asks that? How about you pay us $20 billion? Again, history lesson. Did that work out well for the Huns? I mean, go back and look from the Romans to the Huns. How well did that work out? Not well at all, huh? What do you mean, Dana? I don't understand history. Why can't the U.S. just do that with Mexico? Jeez. Yeah, that's what he asked for. And I don't even know what. I'm sure Biden was like, well, you got a point. I'm sure he was. I wouldn't be surprised. That wouldn't be the first time either. So one of the things I wanted to hit. The other, I got a couple of things here that I wanted to pull out. Get it for you. We had the squatting situation. We had the Sam, Kane asked me if I was going to talk about the same Sam Bankman-Fried stuff. You want my honest opinion on this?
Yeah.
Didn't it mostly affect the lefties?
Well, I mean, he mostly...
And Hollywood people?
Yeah, he mostly donated to lefties.
And it affected, like, the people whose money went missing, it was lefties and Hollywood people?
Yeah, I mean, not exclusively, but yeah.
But mostly?
Yeah.
That's my response. You can quote me again as...
There's some legitimate victims, though, what ended up happening.
Have you seen this guy?
Yeah.
Would you give him money? This is why judging on appearance is important. And anyone who tells you otherwise, they're lying.
This is less about him getting a bunch of money, but him creating a bunch of money out of thin air with ETFs and things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's what it was. And that money was spread around to Democrats.
Yeah, to Democrats. That's why I feel like, isn't it sort of a self-solving issue here? Am I being mean? I'm not trying to be callous. I just don't see why I need to show concern for leftists trying to do shady stuff. And they got caught. And they hurt other leftists in the process. And he looks like that.
Yeah,
I mean,
the thing is, I think a lot of people see this as the left using this kid. And now he's the fall guy. Like, this is a kid.
He was dumb enough to do it.
Well, yeah, he's a kid. Of course he's dumb enough.
Define kid.
He's a guy dumb enough.
He's 32 years old.
He's a kid.
Wait, are you in the infant baby fetus Hunter Biden club?
Hold on, wait a minute. Whoa.
He's 32 years old. He's not a kid.
Hold on. Does that mean our Constitution, who requires you to be 35 as president, is now somehow lacking?
That's irrelevant. That doesn't mean you're a child.
It doesn't mean you're qualified or at least adult enough to
even... We're not talking about president of the United States.
No, we're
not. Like, oh, he's a kid. He got used. He's 32 years old.
So you don't think a 32-year-old got used by Democrats? Is
that
what you're saying? You don't think he got used
term,
by Democrats?
No, you're not going to do this, Mott Bailey, on me. You said that he was a kid. I'm saying he's not a kid. He's old enough to know better. That's my whole point. And okay. No, I don't feel bad that he got taken because he was dumb. He shouldn't have.
Yeah, he's definitely dumb. He got taken advantage of. That's literally the point I make. I'm not defending anything he's
There's
doing.
There's a scarcity of... I have a scarcity of sympathy for stuff like this. There really is.
I
don't have a lot of it, and it's not a self-renewing thing.
I can relate to that.
It's not a renewable energy with me. And I don't have any.
But
there.
He was taken advantage of, and not only that, Democrats soaked
Democrats
in millions.
Took advantage of someone.
I know. It's
That's
not a
never
surprise.
Happened.
But they took in millions, and I'm wondering
Infant
how many.
Infant fetus Sam Bankman-Fried.
I'm wondering how many. Stop it. I'm wondering how many actually gave that money back.
Yeah, he's just I don't care. He just literally does not affect me.
It's a crime enough for him to get 25 years.
He's so he messed up. He's dumb.
How much did Bob Menendez get?
I don't feel bad for him.
How many gold bars?
But he's not a baby. He's 32 years old.
No, I didn't say he was a baby.
I mean, I had like bills and kids and mortgage when I was 32 years old. Like
I'm
a grown whole ass person. I mean, I don't. You know, he's 32. Infant baby fetus, Sam Bankman-Fried, little infant baby. His little onesie.
Well, he'll be old enough when he gets
out
of prison.
Little baby Einstein. Huh?
When he gets out of prison, he'll be old enough.
Yeah, he will. All right, so we got more on the way as we roll towards the conclusion of our third hour. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
Follow Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts, because knowledge is your ultimate superpower.
Does your child's choice of clothing make you uncomfortable? Does your non-binary child want to wear one type of clothing one day and the next type of clothing the other day? And by type, I mean stereotypically male or female. If this makes you uncomfortable, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to a store. You can even buy it online. Buy something returnable that is what you would consider opposite gender to how you experience life.
Did she put this music on?
Buy it, receive it, try it on. Do this in private if you want. This is a very intimate, vulnerable experience.
This is so stupid.
And stay with the vulnerability.
Who has this kind of time? Stay with that vulnerability. What the hell world word salad is that? Stay with the vulnerability. Sorry for the Portuguese. That's so dumb. This is a woman named Rena. She sounds like one of those Munchausen moms. Munchausen mom. She says, I have a beautiful transgender non-binary child. Can you be the tooth? If you're non-binary, then you're binary because you're non-binary, and it's binary or non-binary, right? Okay, that's binary.
Child.
I have a beautiful transgender non-binary child. Oh, wow. So she's like, it's like she created an issue to be an expert on, and now she's telling parents to cross-dress to help them feel comfortable with their child being it being trans. She's given a TED talk. What is that? I don't even know what those are, actually. I think they sound dumb. Yeah, she gave it to, I don't know what. She uses concept and skills of a bunch of BS. She says, I'm not a therapist. She goes, I'm a sensitive, empathetic, seasoned parent and coach. She's a professional Karen. To the women named Karen, don't. I didn't make up the name. I know. I get you. You're excluded from that. She says, I don't even know what she does. What does she do? Mindfulness and meditation. Sounds like she does nothing. She is a professional, you know, Kate plus eight woman of leisure. That's what it sounds like. Cross dress. You have. Let's mark this for tomorrow, too. All right. Dane stupidity.
All right. One, this is cut four. This is Joyless Reid on MSNBC.
This should be nice.
Joyless had this to say.
Brandon Scott was elected with 70% of the vote in 2020 in a city that is 61% black. So by right-wing logic, a diversity hire would have been a white man, which, of course, is what they want. Only the white Christian men may have the things.
What the heck is she
talking at this point,
about?
It's evident what they mean by DEI, right? Okay, it means black people.
Sorry, the racist rift just never ends. Apparently, there's still value
there.
Does
she have any new tricks? Because these are really boring and predictable now. I'm bored. All right, folks, that does it for us today. Make sure you sign up for the newsletter over at Substack, chapter numbers. Find us YouTube, Facebook, like, and subscribe back. We'll see you tomorrow.